So I'm going to talk about selection of lithium-ion cells in BMS. You can go next. What is a lithium-ion cell? Like, you know, there's a basic understanding behind it. So when you charge a cell, there's lithium ions flowing from cathode to anode and back when you're discharging it. And advantages of lithium ion batteries compared to other batteries such as, you know, nickel cadmium, nickel metal hydride and lead acid batteries is that it has higher energy density, no memory effect, and low self discharge. Yeah, can you go next? Yeah, these are the various types of chemistry that have been in the market, and that is something that's coming up, especially LNO and LNMO, and the last three, they are on the way to, you know, the market. This LTO was the beginning, 1991. That is something Sony commercialized. And then LTO was slightly modified to NPM and NPA. And separately, around mid of 2000s, there was LFP, and then, which is again further evolving to LMFP, which is coming up. Yeah. Next. Application suitable for popular cell chemistries. In India, the most popular chemistry coming in is LFP and NMC. So these are the applications. LFP has a higher stable chemistry, but it takes up a lot of space. So the volumetric energy density is not so good compared to NMC. It takes up more space. So it is useful, or maybe usable in a bus and e-rickshaw, but in applications such as two-wheelers and cars, it becomes challenging because these markets are sold solely on the purpose of range. Competitors, the market manufacturers compete on range. So for them, it becomes a little difficult to use LFP and hence they use NMC. Next. Understanding the various types of C ratings. Lithium-ion cells come with various standard charge and standard discharge conditions. It is always advisable to use the cells close to these conditions as possible, as much as possible. For example, let's take a popular cell that's coming to India, especially in EV scooters it is used, 2600 mAh NMC cell. Most of the times you see that some of the times you see it is rated as 0.2C or 0.5C. So let's talk about the 0.2C rated cell. You are not supposed to deviate too much from its rating. So 0.2C basically means 520 milliamps. So you should be discharging somewhere close to that. And that is something many companies deviate, and it's not recommended. You have to follow the data sheet. It's all mentioned in the data sheet. Higher discharging rates can deliver lower energy. So that is something, if you are looking to discharge at higher rates, possibly, you know, go with a 0.5C or 1C rated cell, or else you end up getting lesser energy. For example, I'm taking the same 2600 mAh NMC cell. If you discharge at 0.2C rating, which is rated for the cell, you would be getting about 100%. And when you discharge at 0.5C, you would be getting about 95% of the energy. And when you discharge 90%, 1C rating, you would be getting about 90% of the energy. Next. It's important to audit the energy at the end user application. Whenever you make a battery pack as a battery pack company, you need to understand where is this battery going. So accordingly, you are supposed to make a pack. Don't just listen to this application, the companies, or just they just tell, you know, this is the voltage, this is the amps, or this is the continuous current. You also need to understand the behavior of the application. Let's take example of an EV. Maybe ask for a data sheet of the motor and controller. Look at the voltage profile. And also maybe, you know, look into things like, is there a regeneration? Because if there's a regeneration coming back through the controller to the battery, but the BMS doesn't support, then it becomes challenging for the battery. The battery can undergo damage. And in case of energy storage application, understand the realistic power demanded by the load. Don't just take the loads at their value, because there's a lot of efficiency losses, and you need to understand the backup hours also, and accordingly size the battery. Think of cell data sheet as a textbook guide. So whenever you buy a cell, you get a data sheet along with it, follow it. Like that's supposed to be your handbook. I know generally, you know, people think, okay, practical is different and, you know, theory is different, but this is something you should stick to the theory. So a lot of data sheets, you know, they mention a lot of data, a lot of graphs and all that. So one can actually look at things like, you know, internal resistance. Whenever you're buying multiple brands, so the first thing I generally look at is internal resistance. the lower the internal resistance, the better. And follow this, you can see the C rating as well, which I was talking earlier. There's a 0.2 C, there's 0.5 C, there's 1 C rating of discharge. And you have to follow that. If you're trying to deviate from that, suppose you take a 0.2 C rating cell and discharge at 1 C at all times. So you tend to kind of abuse the battery and the cycle life of the battery goes down. And it's not really the manufacturer's fault. They clearly told it in the data sheet, but you have been using it wrong. Make sure the operation temperature is not something which is exceeded. All the data sheet also have a temperature limit for the charging and discharging profile. It's better to keep it in that limit. So for the maximum life cycle of the cell. And follow the depth of discharge. Most of the cells, they come with 80% depth of discharge. You can see that in the cycle life data section. And that is something you should be following. I've seen many companies go with 85, 90, 95. There are some companies who want to extract every juice out of it, like 100%. That's a big no. You shouldn't be doing that. Follow something which is, you know, mentioned in the cycle life data section, because that is the ideal DOD, or that is the maximum DOD depth of discharge that you should be following. Next. Maintaining a healthy SOC range. So have you ever wondered why does a lithium ion cell bulge, or, you know, a pouch cell swell, something like that? So the answer lies in the discharge behavior. So whenever you discharge the battery too much, there is a SEI formation on the anode. So whenever you buy whenever a new cell is made, a new cell is charged very, very slowly for the first few cycles. So that is when some lithium ions and there is an electrolyte, it forms a, you know, a semi-solid kind of structure on the anode. It is called as SEI, solid electrolyte interface. During that time, some lithium ions are kind of staying back. They don't come back. And then when you use the cell, when it comes to a, you know, the application in a battery pack or something like that, and then when you use it, you should not be discharging it too much. So there comes a time when you're actually discharging it too much, and the lithium ions which is on the SEI, so they would be coming back to the cathode while discharging, and that would crack or, you know, damage the SEI. And that would lead to releasing of a lot of gases, especially carbon dioxide. And that is something you would see in a cell phone or something, you know, where the cell has, you know, swollen. Or in a cylindrical or prismatic cell, you would see it like bulging. And that is not it. Just today, I was talking to someone. They are from the solar industry. They were telling the cells are leaking. So the 6AH LFP cell, it was leaking. So they were asking what could be the reason. The first thing I asked them is what is the discharge, you know, the cutoff, the voltage cutoff that you are doing. So most of the time people are going for 2.5. There are companies going all the way to 2.2 as well. That's a big no. You shouldn't be going that deep. So, you know, like I said before, follow the 80% depth of discharge. A good range of SOC would be between 10 to 90%. And it's not highly recommended to charge a cell all the way till 100%. So, you know, when you're reaching very close to 100%, there's a lot of resistance from the cell. That's why you might have seen a cell phone which charges so fast, but when it's nearing 100%, it charges kind of slow. That is because there's a lot of resistance happening for the energy to enter, as well as, you know, the heat is being generated. Resistance is nothing but, you know, not all of the energy is going in. Some of it is lost in the form of heat. And then that is when, you know, you have to worry about thermal management, like the earlier speakers were talking about. Yeah, next. Design the battery voltage as per the application. It's always recommended to size the battery a little higher voltage than the required application. This allows, you know, basically energy is nothing but, you know, V into I, which is voltage into current. So when you are on the higher voltage, so the current drawn would be lesser, especially when the battery is on the lower SOC, below 50% SOC state of charge, it leads to drawing higher current, especially if you would see in NMC. LFP has a flat curve. That's a different thing. But in NMC, you would see the amps coming out of the cell increases. So when you're trying to keep a higher voltage, a little bit higher, it kind of compensates for it. So if the cells don't undergo that kind of, you know, the thermal management issues or, you know, heat generation, is kind of on the lower side. And some NMC cell manufacturers, they claim it's a 3.7 volt nominal voltage. But if you actually see the data of the cells being charged and discharged in application or in a tester or something after a few hundred cycles, the nominal voltage would kind of come down very close to 3.6 volts. That's why, you know, famous brands such as LG, Samsung, Panasonic, from day one, they advertise it as 3.6 volts nominal voltage. And some of the common recommendations that I generally give whenever I interact with the battery pack company is, you know, there are companies using 13S. They take 3.7 volts into 13, they say it's a 48.1, okay, it works. But like I said before, after a few hundred cycles, it kind of comes down to close to 3.6, and that becomes a challenge. So I highly recommend that you go with a 14S. And similar thing, many companies use 16S, which is 59.2 volts from day one. So it is not really 60 volts. When your application is 60 volts, I highly suggest you go for 17S. Yeah. Let's talk about IR, which is impedance or internal resistance. Do you know why LG cells are the most popular choice for EVs? Other than Tesla, most of the companies use LG cells. So there's a reason for it. Tesla uses Panasonic. LG cells have lower internal resistance. Even Indian, you know, the big brands of two-wheelers and all, they all use LG. Maybe in different sizes such as 18650, 21700, but they all use LG. There's a reason for it. The performance is good because the internal resistance is lower. Like I said before, internal resistance matters. And internal resistance refers to the resistance by the cell to the flow of current, which results in the generation of heat. Any heat that is coming out of a battery pack, that would have been, you know, going to the application. So it is highly recommended you choose a cell which has lower internal resistance. And it is a property of a cell for its internal resistance to increase. So from day one, whenever you buy a cell, is say suppose you buy an NMC cell from China, it would be something like 21 or 22 milliohm. And as you're cycling hundreds of cycles and all, you would see it's crossing 30 milliohm. That's not really a good, you know, indication or a good usage of a cell in an EV application, especially scooter application, high speed scooter. Yeah. And there's so much. And recalling of EV battery packs is also important. Like I said before, internal resistance, you know, can increase with aging, and there comes a time when it's too high and unsuitable for use in electric vehicles. So, and also there's a battery degradation. Every time you charge and discharge a cell or a battery in general, some of the lithium ions don't come back. They tend to stay close to SEI, and you know, they pile up, they form a dendrite, and you know, dendrite can actually go all the way, penetrate the separator, and you know, touch a cathode, and that's when, you know, internal short circuit happens and batteries catch fire and all that. So that is something which happens when the, you know, a lot of cycling has been done and the batteries are operating at high, you know, power discharge or fast charging kind of applications. And that is something, you know, in EV. It is bound to happen eventually. That's why a good strategy would be to recall the battery. And what, you know, And EV manufacturers, so how do you recall EV battery packs? So EV manufacturers are supposed to educate its buyers that after a certain degradation, you know, the battery has reached, it has to come back. Like, you know, if you have an iPhone, you would see there's a battery health, you know, space. So there, they mention, like, you know, your battery SOH or state of health is 86%, 82%. The minute it touches 80%, they would send you an alert saying, you know, it's time to replace your battery. So similar thing, you know, EV manufacturers are supposed to do, or else it becomes a big challenge tomorrow. There's a lot of internal resistance increment, and you know, heat management becomes trouble, and electronics also degrade with higher heat. So it becomes a challenge. It's about time, you know, then to call it back. The next thing would be, what do we do with the recall EV battery pack? So recall battery pack could be dismantled, and then, you know, heat cells could be checked for data, like what is the IR. If it has a decent IR, maybe you could use it, reuse it, like we call it the second life battery. It can be reused in solar applications where it's charging in peak hours, 6 hours or something, discharging slowly and all. It's okay to do that. But if the cell's IR is too high and the cell has degraded too much, then it has to go for recycling. There's no other option. It cannot go anywhere. Let's talk about BMS. What is a BMS? Battery management system. Basically, it manages the battery pack by giving basic protection and, you know, such as operating outside is protection from operating outside a safe operation zone, and you know, controlling its environment could be like temperature or, you know, voltage or the flow of current and all that. And it can additionally calculate data, report data via various communication protocols. types of BMS. So there are two types of BMS. One is hardware BMS, and then there is software BMS. Hardware BMS gives you all kinds of protection, basic protection that a battery pack needs to keep it healthy. Software BMS, it does everything that a hardware BMS does, but additionally, you know, it can collect data, and it can have a memory card inside to store data so that tomorrow, whenever you get it, you can actually remove the memory card or, you know, or send the data via, you know, CAN or UART or something like that. And then it can support GPS tracking module. And, you know, it can send you data in a vehicle. Suppose it's in a vehicle, you can actually get the data via Bluetooth. This is the functions of a BMS, general functions. Yeah, so like I told before, it can take care of the voltage, current, temperature, and it can look at the SOC, which is the state of charge, which can be like on a vehicle, you see, you know, this much of range is left. That is the function of a SOC. And depth of discharge, how the battery has been, you know, how much of the energy has been, you know, used every cycle and all that. And SOH, how much of the battery, the energy, the capacity is left, how much is degraded, that kind of thing. State of power indicating how much of, this is more of a ESS application where, you know, you're connected to load, continuous load or something, and then it will tell you, okay, at this kind of load, you would get power for this kind of time. Yeah. Yeah. Useful parameters in BMS. So this is something any battery packer would be interested to know. So if you observe the discharge graph in an empty cell, there's not much energy left after the cell drops, you know, below 3 volts. The nominal is 3.6 to 3.7. So, but I've seen companies going all the way to 2.7 and all that. There's not much. Like I told before, you should be operating at depth of discharge of 80%, which any cell manufacturer recommends. So it's not highly recommended to go below 3 volts. And whenever you take a BMS, so you have, again, there's a tolerance involved. So maybe you can take a 2.9 volt, you know, a lot of IC support 2.9 volt lower cutoff. So you could use a BMS which is using that kind of IC. And with a little bit of tolerance, it would cut off your battery at about 3 volts. Similarly, in LFP, below 2.7 volts, there's not much energy left here. So people are going 2.5, and like I told someone called me in the morning, they're going all the way to 2.2 volts. Not, it's a big note. And then next thing is the upper cutoff voltage. So in NMC, it's 4.2 and 3.6, which is, you know, the maximum. And many companies tend to go all the way to maximum. Again, like I said, when you want to operate at 80%, cut off 10% on the bottom, 10% on the top. So you shouldn't be touching 4.2 in NMC or 3.6 in LFP. It's not recommended. And OEMs should use controllers that have, you know, that cut off the battery before the BMS does. So that's actually the right way of any OEM, you know, they should design a vehicle in that way. So some companies have already adopted, but a lot of companies actually are depending on the BMS to cut off. So it's kind of like a function of a motor controller to cut off the battery when it reaches a certain voltage. Yeah. And then the last thing I would like to say is, you know, if you actually, like I told, don't go all the way to 4.2 volt full charge. And what if you go all the way to 4.1 and not beyond that? Your cycle life would actually be very close to double. Because heat generation, like I told before, there's a lot of resistance from the cells in the end. A lot of heat generation, it degrades the battery, and battery degradation is directly linked to the cycle life of the cell. So your cycle life would improve drastically if you're actually restricting the higher voltage cutoff at 4.1 volts. Yeah. Batteries are classified as dangerous goods. Please handle it with the right hand. Yeah. Thank you.